time. But I thank and praise that we're all able to make it here safely. Today we celebrate the Transfiguration of our Lord. And so I'm up here before announcements. We're to have a procession. We'll have the gospel procession. We'll follow the order of service as it is laid out for us in the Divine Service Setting 1 on page 151. I'd like to remind you to look over your bulletin extension. We have a couple of announcements. We have Verna's 90th birthday. Her celebration, not her birthday, has changed. So March 10th will be her celebration from 2 to 4. We have the choir from the seminary coming on March 24th at 3 p.m. Come out and see and support them. Ash Wednesday, Lent starts this Wednesday, and we'll have services at 4 and 7. And then we have the LWML prayer service, which is today. That has been canceled. So please mark your calendars, and if you know any members of the LWML, please let them know. And again, look at all the other announcements for both the church and the school. And as always, because we've gathered so many today, please mark your attendance cards. Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Dear beloved, I have good news. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Slain, whose blood set us free to give.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, in the glorious transfiguration of your beloved Son, you confirmed the mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. In the voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshadowed our adoption by grace. Mercifully make us co-heirs with the King in his glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. You may be seated for the readings.
Our Old Testament reading this morning comes from Deuteronomy chapter 34. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho. And the Lord showed him all the land, Gilead as far as Dan, all Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negev and the plain, that is the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees as far as Zoar. And the Lord said to him, this is the land of which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. I will give it to your offspring. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not go over there. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord. And he buried him in the valley in the land of Moab, opposite Beth Peor. But no one knows the place of his burial to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eye was undimmed and his vigor unabated. And the people of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the days of weeping and mourning for Moses were ended. And Joshua, the son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands on him. So the people of Israel obeyed him and did as the Lord had commanded Moses. And there has not arisen a prophet since in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. None like him for all the signs and the wonders that the Lord sent him to do in the land of Egypt, to Pharaoh and to all his servants and to all his land, and for all the mighty power and all the great deeds of terror that Moses did in the sight of Israel. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Prepare us for
Our epistle reading this morning comes from Hebrews chapter 3. Therefore, holy brothers, you who share in a heavenly calling, consider Jesus, the apostle and high priest of our confession, who is faithful to him who appointed him, just as Moses also is faithful in all God's house. For Jesus has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, as much more glory as the builder of a house has more honor than the house itself. For every house is built by someone, but the builder of all things is God. Now Moses was faithful in all God's house as a servant, to testify to the things that were to be spoken later. But Christ is faithful over God's house as a son. And we are his house, if indeed we hold fast our confidence and our boasting and our hope. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel.
The Holy Gospel, according to St. Luke, the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and went up on the mountain to pray. And as he was praying, the appearance of his face was altered, and his clothing became dazzling white. And behold, two men were talking with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and those who were with him were heavy with sleep, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. And as the men were parting from him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. As he was saying these things, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my son, my chosen one. Listen to him." And when the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent and told no one in those days anything of what they had seen. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Thank you.
Grace, peace, and mercy be unto you from God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Gracious Father, we thank and praise you for safe travel to your house, that we may have, receive, and have strengthening of faith as we live in the gift of Christ our Lord coming to us this day. To this end, use the words that flow from these lips to proclaim your great mercy in Christ Jesus. Amen. There's this old saying, and it says, I can see farther because I stand on the shoulders of giants. And I think of this when we hear our Old Testament lesson. We have a God taking Moses to the mountain, and he's able to look and behold the promised land. They have made it. And then Moses realizes and knows that, yes, Israel will go, but he gets to remain, and he dies at the age of 120, and he is buried. But with that, think of that glorious sight. Think of that, the accomplishment, the feeling of accomplishment that Moses had. For 40 years, he took these people and walked and walked and walked until they have arrived now. And the prophecy, the fulfillment, the promise of God to keep and hold his people until the promised land has been fulfilled. And we hear that Moses is called the faithful servant. No one in Israel was like him. And so again, we get that wonderful picture of the promised land. And then we have our gospel lesson, which is the Transfiguration. And again, we're on top of a mountain, and we get to see. We get to see that Jesus, his face, his clothes become dazzling white. And you got Peter, James, and John, they're heavy with sleep. And when they wake up, when they're fully awake, they get to see that there is Jesus in his glory. There is Moses and Elijah also with him. And they get to really kind of see a peek into heaven. And what's amazing about that is they see and understand this is the glory of God right before us. And we hear that Peter quickly thinks, let's build tents. We'll build one for Jesus, one for Moses, one for Elijah, and we'll keep them there. And we'll have them there, and we will get to be participants of Jesus and his glory and Moses and Elijah. And I don't fault Peter for saying that, because again, if you had God who came down, literally came down and said, I am here for you, what do you want to do? And it's not that Jesus wants to go out and watch a movie with you, but the idea that he comes to be with you, what questions would you ask? What would you do? How would you act? Would you want Jesus to come and always be with you, knowing that you have the comfort of your Lord right here? No matter what takes place, he is physically there. Now, this is an easy sermon illustration. What would you do if Jesus showed up? Of course, we would thank and praise him. Of course, we would worship. But how long would you revert? How long would it be until you reverted back to your old ways? Jesus, can you look away? I got to go do something. I'll be right back, or whatever it may be. But yet we have Peter who says, it is good that we are here. It is good that we get to witness, we get to have and behold this wondrous gift of the transfiguration, the fullness of God being shown in Christ our Lord. And being Transfiguration Sunday, this is the last Sunday of Epiphany. And this is really God in Jesus saying, I am revealing myself to you so that you will know that I have come for you, that my salvation will be yours, and I promise to dwell with you, not necessarily in a tent made by you, but in my word and in my promise. And this is the same thing that we get to hold on to, not only this day, but as we travel into Lent. When we start Lent, Ash Wednesday, the 6th, the colors will change. We kind of get a little bit darker. The message kind of points inward. We start talking about our sins. We talk about who we are and the need of salvation. But in this, we get to be reminded that the light of Christ, the transfiguration, the promise of God is what leads us even to the depths of our sin, that we may come out and we may see farther. We may see the promised land because we are held in God's hands, in Christ's hands. In fact, this is what we prayed in the collect. Mercifully make us co-heirs with the King in his glory. Bring us to the fulfillment of our inheritance in heaven. And this is what I get to remind you of, that you have that very inheritance right here, right now. You have God here to and for you. Now, we're not seeing some transfiguration. We're not seeing some apparition. We get to hear him. We get to receive him. But he has promised to be here. And we have the whole idea that this is the mount that we get to mount, that we get to be called up to. And we get to have our Lord come to us in his body and his blood. It really is as if he has set up camp to be here to feed and give and deliver. And the great joy about this is we have the altar, and especially in the Old Testament, the altar was always a place of sacrifice. This is where you went to slaughter the animal, to offer the offering of thanksgiving for the sin offering or whatever have you. And today, we have the offering that God has already done in Christ our Lord. The full and complete sacrifice already completed is here for you. It's not that we're re-sacrificing. It's not that we're recreating. This is what has already been done, and we get to be connected to this gift, the promise of Christ being here for you. So once again, we come into the chancel. We come in the presence of God. We get to come to the mountain where God promises to deliver himself. And this is reminiscent of what we're going to talk about later in Lent, especially closer to Holy Week. We have another mountain that Peter, James, and John are called to go up with Jesus. And this is the Mount of Olives. And Jesus goes and he prays before the betrayal. And he prays that the will of God, his Father, will take place. And he asks, if this cup can pass from me, let it be, but let your will be done. We have a wonderful stained glass window depicting that prayer. It's right next to the front doors. And there he asked Peter, James, and John to pray with him. And he stands up after his prayer and he goes to them, and not that I'm using vicar or field worker as an example, but goes over to them and wakes them up and says, can you not pray with me for an hour? The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And this is where we find ourselves, and this is why we need what is given and delivered to us this day. Our flesh is weak. We are tossed to and fro with the things that are taking place in the world, the things that are taking place in our lives, and how quickly do we forget the gifts that we have, the gift of being adopted, the gift of salvation, the gift of being called God's own child, so that we can feed the delights of our flesh, our wants, our desires. But yet we're not left without the Spirit. We're not left without knowing that here we are called to the Mount of God, the altar of God, to receive the very gifts of God that cover, that support, that help this weak flesh. This is why we in all delight, all praise and thanksgiving, all excitement come, not just to hear God's word, not just to participate in the divine service, but to know that God promises to be here so that you will know salvation. We get to say with St. Peter, it is good that we are here. In fact, in the intro, we kind of say that. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. And we get to come here where he promises to dwell in word and sacrament so that we will have salvation, so that we will know peace, so we will know that God in his glory has come, so that we will be his children. We will be the people that he carries to the true promised land in the resurrection. Let us always look forward to this promise. Let us know that we are being carried and held by the King who has defeated sin, death, and hell. And we await not just the resurrection, but we await forevermore in his glory. This is yours in the faith created and sustained by God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Please stand as we confess our faith through the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in the Holy Christian and Apostolic Church, I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of God, for the renewal of our faith, and for the salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord. For peace in the world, for the strengthening of the holy churches of God, for the unity of the church in doctrine and in piety, and for this holy house, that those who enter here may do so in faith, reverence, and the fear of God, let us pray to the Lord. For our country, the president, and all those in public offices, for this parish and city, and for the faithful in them, for favorable weather, for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, for all honorable vocations, businesses, and industries, let us pray to the Lord. For this parish, for all pastors and missionaries, but especially for our pastor and those who serve us in the Lord's name, let us pray to the Lord. For travelers, that they may be kept safe, for those who suffer for the sake of Christ, for those who defend our nation, for those who labor for lawful order, and those who work on behalf of the poor and the oppressed, let us pray to the Lord. For those who suffer from illnesses of body and mind, for the healing grace of body and blood, that those who suffer may know God's strength, comfort, and peace in their afflictions, especially Ken, Judy, Jim, Pat, Ellen, Sonia, David, Karen, Della, Dorothy, Cindy, Nancy, Matt, Chuck, and Diana. We pray also for Dakota, Tom, Jim, Nancy, Chris, Harper, Norma, Charlene, Garrett, Elaine, Leona, Eloise, Peggy, Elfrida, Alicia, Amy, Mike, Ron, and Mona. And we continue to pray for Bill, Clara, Craig, Steve, Larry, Ruth, Virginia, Janet, Gary, Grace, Jeff, Michelle, Ann, Mary Lou, Ruth, Lydia, Karen, Stephanie, Ernest, Sue, Greg, and Marvin. We pray for the mercy of God to provide for all according to their need. Let us pray to the Lord. For ears that hearken to your voice, speaking through your word,
for holy lips to receive Christ's blessed sacrament with faith and repentance, and for a sense of holy awe at the glory of God granted to us in the means of grace. Let us pray to the Lord. For the fellowship of God's people gathered around the world and the table of the Lord. For the lonely, that they may rejoice in the community of faith. For the homebound, that they may be kept in prayer and sustained through the gracious visitation of God's people and their pastor. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, your power is beyond compare and your glory beyond understanding. Open our hearts to know you through the glory of your Son, whose saving will and purpose have rescued us from sin and death, and made us your own people by baptism and faith. For you, O Lord, to you, O Lord, belongs all honor and glory, worship and praise, blessed and eternal Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and to the ends of the ages. Amen. You may be seated as we collect the offering.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who at his transfiguration revealed his glory to his disciples, that they might be strengthened to proclaim his cross and resurrection, and with all the faithful look forward to the glory of life everlasting. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created, and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us to do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Ghost, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do, as oft as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in love towards one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.